What is Dharmic culture? It's a culture where everyone talks about their interaction with the saints and with the grace of God and with the miracles of God and their awakening to realization, non-dualization. That's a Dharmic culture. And so in the past we've had Dharmic cultures where people, you meet someone who's Dharmic and they talk about what the miracles they've had today and recently, and the miracles they expect to have, and the help of the grace of God, how it's helped them, and how to pray properly, and how to receive properly, how to listen properly. That's called a Dharmic culture. Dharma is a sort of general term for everything associated, oriented towards the grace of God, which is designed to wake us up from this pretending, pretense of becoming. In reality, everything is instantaneous, boundlessly instantaneous, boundlessly instantaneous. There's no such thing as becoming. So we're pretending that there's this vast universe of becoming. This is just pretense, our imagination. And there's no point in a dream, or also in pretending, that's distant from the pretender. So when we're pretending something, how distant is that pretending? When is that pretending not happening right now? If I pretend that my arm is like stuck like this, at what point is this arm actually stuck? Does it become actually stuck? Right? The answer is right now, it's un can be unstuck. It's never stuck. It's pretending. So the entire dream of conditioned existence is like that. There's no point where it's stuck, it's fixated. It never becomes fixated. Reality never crystallizes. It's never fixated. It's always boundlessly immediate, boundlessly instantaneous. So the Dharmic culture interacts with the saints. From ne it now and those who have been here before, and maybe those who will be here, other moments, we call it the future, but yet to be here, we interact with the grace of God. This is Dharmic culture, and in Dharmic cultures, like for instance, like India, Tibet, so much interaction with saints, the people. Here in Western culture, it's like virtually nil. Virtually nil. It's become like virtually extinct. But in Dharmic cultures, you get to actually see the gurus. You get to see the Dharma Kings. You get to actually, I mean, how poverty stricken we are to be in a non-Dharmic culture here in the United States, Western world. Unbelievably poverty stricken. I mean, this is like a shanty town. Ghetto. It's like an Irish shanty town, in Irish, like potato famine. You can like it. It's like a spiritual potato famine situation here in the United States. And what did the Irish do? They had to leave. They had to go somewhere else to get some food. There was nothing to eat. And here, spiritually, there's nothing to eat. I had a dream last night where I looked on my body. I pulled my shirt up, and there in my lower right abdomen was this huge black spot that was all growing. It was like this hideous skin cancer. Well, this refers to the world being superficial, a cancer of superficiality. We say, skin deep, cancer, skin deep. What was that? A cat was chasing a squirrel, a baby squirrel, right through here. What in the world was that? I don't know. Never seen that before. We're distracted, very distracted here, from the dark, from Dharma, Dharmic culture, and so this cancer, a skin cancer of superficiality, is very bad. It was extremely bad what I saw in the dream, and something like that is going to spread. Skin cancer is very deadly; it spreads very prolifically, and so. This cancer, the spiritual cancer of superficiality, is spread throughout the world right now. That's not Dharmic culture. We have a spirituality culture, you might say, spirituality culture, and which is a belief in really ultimately in, the answer is oscillation between truth and lies, oscillation between truth and pretension, oscillation. It's based on that belief that that's, the ego says that's the cure, and I found out it isn't the cure. It only leads to total mental chaos, which is, we cannot abide in that. We don't feel capable of abiding in that. So that's never the answer. So the spirituality is superficial. Okay, so what we've had is spread throughout the world is a spirituality. All the psychic stuff, crystals, energy, all this kind of stuff. That the whole New Age is spirituality. That's superficial. That's like a skin cancer. And that's taken the place of genuine Dharmic culture. And so many think that, oh yeah, we have spirituality now. And we can wear our tie-dye shirts and, you know, blow bubbles and say, you know, we're spiritual, got spirituality. That's, so this cancer has spread throughout the world, and most are oblivious to Dharmic culture at this point. They're going to go to their graves absolutely oblivious of it. Being Dharmic means you have experiences with the saints. You interact with them. You have inner experiences, all sorts of breakthroughs, glimpses of truth, glimpses of enlightenment, glimpses of awakening. You practice, you're dedicated. You know, that's Dharmic culture. And the world used to have quite a bit of that, actually. And the various religions had Dharmic cultures. Absolutely, they did. Christianity used to be very Dharmic culture. And you could still see, you know, traces of that. I talked to some Christians, and it's still there. You know, they talk about the saints, the grace of God, the miracles, and the blessings, and how God works in their lives. And that's the conversation you have with them. And then you're able to share this information of how to benefit from the grace of God, to help us realize that no matter how much we pretend, it's never fixated. Fixation's impossible. And somehow we think that we can oscillate between believing fixation's possible and believing it's impossible, and call that spirituality, and we'll be happy. In no way will that make us happy. So to be Dharmic is to share the Dharma, and that's what I've tried to do my whole life, with very little success, actually. And probably that's the experience of most everyone here, is you meet a stone wall, where do you go to just talk like this? You know, you meet somebody and say, God bless you. I met someone recently who, he said, yeah, I grew up with miracles. This is my mom. Was a miracle worker with the grace of God, believed in the saints and the Holy Spirit, and she did many, many miracles, including bringing rain and all sorts of miracles. And he totally believed in miracles, and he said, we saw something together. He said, that's a blessing of God upon us. There's no question. I said, you're right, no question about it. Super rare to come across something like that, isn't it? Is almost extinct. So, you know, what can be done? I've tried my very best to just push out as much Dharma as I can, talking about my experiences. Many, 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 vast number of experiences with the saints, with the Dharma Kings. But I'd sure like more, a lot more. But who would listen? Who would listen, really? I mean, it's amazing. If I met Jesus today, I would say I'd met Jesus today. This is what happened, and maybe nobody would even comment on it. That's been my experience. I've had many meetings with Jesus, tremendous experiences. Put those up, and you know, no interest, no comments at all. It's like, what? Are you kidding me? So the Dharma is a living Dharma. You know, it's not about Jesus 2,000 years ago. That's part of it. That's part of it. But it's also about Jesus right now. More importantly, Jesus right now. I just ordered a book for my wife. I mentioned that Tom Carpenter wrote his book, Dialogues on Awakening. He heard was talking with Jesus in his mind, apparently, that Jesus addressed him, and he was able to converse with Jesus, and he wrote a book, Dialogues on Awakening. And I told her about it. She goes, "Get that book for me. I want to read that book." And so I ordered it. Boom, just like that. See, that's Dharmic. That's Dharmic. When you hear something, you say, "Get that book. Get that. I want to read that book. I want to focus on that. That interests me." And then I, responded, in a Dharmic way. I say, "Yeah, keep the focus on that." But this is, disappearing from the world to an extreme extent. And we don't react to what the world is doing. We're beyond that. We're beyond that. We have a news story which is always going to be vastly more interesting than anything that's going on in the world. And that news story is our awakening from pretense. Okay? Our awakening from the pretense of becoming. That is the most compelling story there it will ever be. Okay? Story there will be. Beyond that is just unbounded immediate glory. But before we experience that, we will experience our awakening from the pretense of becoming. So we always have the new story. We are the new story, okay? And keep that in mind. When you're part of Dharmic culture, you are the new story. We are the new story. Not the non-Dharmic profane culture. They don't have any new stories really at all. Not at all. Just absurd silliness is all they have actually. And it's always been that way. So to be Dharmic is to continue to focus on this epic story of awakening from the pretension of becoming. That is the only real issue, the only story in town. All right? And if you're on that boat, you're on the right boat. If you're not, you're missing the boat. And Dharma culture really is ecumenical because there's a great story of awakening from pretension. We're all pretending. We're all caught up in the pretense of becoming. Whatever, wherever we live on this planet, right? Wherever we call home, whatever gender, race, whatever, age, okay? We're all caught up in this delusion of trying to fixate the mind, actually, fixate hallucination. Hallucinating the absence of reality, which is this immediate, this unbounded immediacy of experiencing. So we're all in this boat of needing to wake up from this delusion of fixation, just and realize it's just all pretension, and pretension never actually fixates at all. Again, if I'm pretending my arm's like this, at what point is it actually fixated? At what point is there actually fixation? When does pretense stop? If I'm trying to fixate, the fact is, no matter how long I hold the arm here, it's still not fixated, right? I can still move. Of course, you don't want to stretch analogy too far. My rigor mortis might set in, but you get the idea. In a dream, what point is a dream of fixation fixated? And the answer is, of course, it's always a dream, right now. Right, and it's always right now. A dream. When is a dream of fixation? It's always right now. We're dreaming it right this instant. No matter how long the dream continues on, it's moment by moment by moment. Dreaming is always moment by moment, and the dream is never separated from the dreamer by time, space, process, or form. Never. This is critical to hear this, and hearing it, you take a great step forward. You don't have to analyze it academically. That's non-dharmic. academics is non-dharmic, very much so, very profane. Because what we're speaking of here is self-evident truth. And the reaction to self-evident truth is something quite different than an academic reaction. You have this sort of like, you know, this conviction. When you hear this, you say, oh, I've been convicted of folly. You know, yeah, but that's great. Because now I see it, I get to release myself from it. We're convicted and our sentence is release from it. We get to be release ourselves from folly. So, but first we have to realize we have been so foolish, haven't we, to believe that a dream of fixation somehow separates from the dreamer and from the dream. It's real. And so, but we don't think about it. It's obviously self-evident. The words are, of course, vague and fuzzy, but we know what we're talking about. Anyone can get that. Say, wow, you know. At what point does a dream separate from the dreamer? When is dreaming not right now? When is dreaming not right now? When we fall asleep and we're dreaming, what point in that dream, while we're asleep dreaming, at what point in that dream is it not a dream anymore? And at what point is it somehow not right now, the dreaming? At what point is it not right now? Just hear that. Yeah, just hear that. It's like fertilizer. We're just fertilizing the flower, and eventually, you know, it blooms. You can't force the bloom. You can't try to grab it and pull the petals open academically, you know, intellectually try to pry the flower open. You'll ruin the flower. It'll fall to, you have to allow it to bloom. You cannot force it. Now, spiritually, the workout we're doing spiritually is helpful. Just like working out physically can carry you through a tough period. I just have experience with that. And yeah, my overall fitness carried the day. It really did, through a great deal of fatigue, lack of sleep, etc. And now I'm bouncing back from that and feeling stronger. So it made a huge difference. But nothing you can measure exactly. It just, you know, just the whole core strength carries you through. Same with the Dharma. When you have a very core strength of Dharma, it will carry you through times that are apostate times, which are certainly upon us. And we're asking the Dharma Kings to do more so we can talk about it. You know, if we're not being contacted, what can we say? It gets a little stale when you're still talking about 2,000 years ago. Fortunately, I've been updated and been contacted by all the Dharma Kings that I talk about. You can talk about Manjushri, you can talk about Padmasambhava, you can talk about Longchenpa, you can talk about Jamyang Khenchi Choki Lodro, then you can talk about Jesus Christ, you can talk about Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and you can talk about Rama Maharshi. All of those I have had interaction with, some quite a bit during this lifetime, during the last 60 years here. I'm in a parking lot recently, and this beggar comes up to me. I say, okay. I'm in a good mood. I say, you know, let's see how this goes. And, you know, he gives his spiel, and I look at him. I say, oh my gosh. He looked just like Nisargadatta Maharaj. And I said, you look just like a good, you look really similar to a really good friend of mine. And he goes, really? I said, yeah, you really, really do. So I gave him a bunch of money. Because for me, it was a blessing. It was like Maharaj was saying, yeah. You know, he sent that beggar to me in a parking lot. And then another beggar came up to me in a wheelchair. And I listened to her. And the gist of what she really said, she emphasized it over, she says, be very careful what you wish for, because you're going to get it. And she talked about, a problem that she had that put her in the wheelchair. She got really angry, and then she cried out, "I hope something bad happens to me. I'm so upset." And then just after that, it did. Exactly what she asked for happened. And she said, "Don't ever get angry and wish for anything when you're really angry." Although, of course, we could wish for contact with the Dharma Kings. Maybe we should get more angry more often and wish for contact. Maybe that's what we need to do. Get really, really angry. But we don't have to get really angry, but get very emotional. Recently, I have been very emotional and say, calling them down with, almost tears. Very emotional, very intense. So maybe that's the key to it all. Instead of lukewarmness, it's not easy to get to that, but I have been getting to that recently. And the Dharmic culture expects contact with saints. That's what it's built on. It's not built on theory. It's built on contact with the saints, with the gurus, all right? With the sages, with the Dharma kings. It's built on actual contact with them. Jesus walked this world, not in my mind, walked this world. These Dharma kings have been here and interacted with multitudes, so many, 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 many. And people came away to, and they're miracles, miraculous interactions, and people came talking about this. Wow. But there's been a massive attempt to stamp this out in the world by many, many, many different special interests, actually. Those who want to go on, pretending that they can, there's a way to fixate the mind so that they can imagine they have a separate creation from God. We're hallucinating the absence of God by overlooking intrinsic spaciousness through perception. And there are those who feel that gives them a kick as far as thinking that they're better, greater than God. They have a separate creation, and that they can include God in that by oscillating, right? Oscillating between fixation and non-fixation. Some foolish something like that. So they're trying to wipe out Dharmic culture for sure. And superficiality leads us away. Music leads us away too. I was certainly guilty of that, being a romantic composer in Victorian times from Germany, having my music be very famous and continues to this day. The music's terrible, by the way. I mean, I don't even like it. I was listening to some yesterday by Arthur Rubinstein playing the piano. I just said, "Ugh, it's junk. It's no good." But people loved it, and they still do. I don't know why. I don't even like my own music. I request people, don't listen to it. Don't waste your time. Actually, don't waste your time. It's junk. It's I don't know. What was I thinking? I was an idiot. But it was superficially profound, really. I was trying to reach some sort of profoundness, but it wasn't really dharmic. It was superficial. And but people think it's profound. It's not. It's not. It's not dharmic. It's not dharmic. So music is how one of the main ways that we waylaid ourselves from the dharma. Dharma generally doesn't listen to too much music. The music they do listen to, it's usually prayer, petition. Indian, they call it sankirtana, of Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Someone calls it out, and then everyone responds. Call and response, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. It should be dharmic music, but it should be limited in scope. Music is very insidious how we have gotten led away from Dharmic culture. One of the main mediums was certainly music, and certainly is today. And unfortunately, just because it's classical music started it really leading us away from the Dharma, from Dharmic culture. And people thought they didn't need Dharmic culture anymore because they had this very sophisticated symphonic, great concertos and all this various stuff that was, they thought they were so sophisticated. They said, "Oh, this is like we're getting nearer to God, as if music is God." It's not. There's so many, many people who worship musicians and composers, and you go on YouTube, and like Ricky Martin has like, what is it, like 60 billion, you know, one of his videos is in the high billions of views, you know, billions. I mean, so I'm trying to atone. I know Jesus says atonement is forgive yourself, but really, I see it more as more than that, because if you help lead people astray through music, then I feel obligated to try to help lead them back to the Dharma. You know, to make amends, to make amends. So I've been trying to make amends my entire life, trying to stay away from music, because I know that this is insidious. Music's very insidious. Still is. Sometimes we like to sing a little, sing and dance a little bit, but we should understand that that's non-dharmic, okay? It's non-dharmic. And that should be very clearly pointed out. This is very non-dharmic, and you must limit it and get back to dharmic consideration and stick with that resolutely, even though occasionally you may want to, you know, chew some bubble gum. You know, that, yeah, we can't be overly severe. We have to be realistic. But recently, I've not been listening to any music, not singing at all, not doing a lot of things, not taking pictures, not taking videos, not just trying to be more, much more dharmic, actually, in many, many, many ways. Trying to set an example for the world, and trying to make amends for, you know, in getting people interested in classical music when they should have been paying attention to the Holy Spirit. Because that's the real music, the music of unbounded, instantaneous glory. Unborn, instantaneous, unborn glory. That's the real music, is our flowing, the flow of experiencing. In a form, our formless flow of experiencing with essence, and giving up the dream of fixation. That's what we're all called to here. We're not called to entertainment. You talk about karma. You think you're helping people by producing beautiful music, or at least sophisticated, profound music, because people thought they're highbrow. They listen to my music, they say, well, we're very highbrow, we're very sophisticated, we're very intellectual, only highbrows can understand this music. Well, there's nothing really to understand, to tell you the truth. I was trying to represent, you cannot represent reality. You cannot represent it. You can only experience it, actually directly. You can only be it. You can only be it. You can't represent being. You have to be it. But people would scratch their head and say, "What's he getting at?" And those who, you know, acted like they knew what I was getting at, you know, it was pretentious. You know, I really wasn't. I don't really. That just junk. I mean, what can I say? People say, "Well, some of the greatest music ever composed." It's junk. It's junk. I have to report that to you. So again, I apologize for wasting your time or listening to it, and I'm trying to atone for that by saying, look, pay attention to what's really important, and it's not music. It's not music. Music is not important. It's a diversion. And if you look at modern music, if you look at what's happened in culture, you have to say it's probably the number one culprit, along with our education and socialization, television. But music's been interlaced in marketing, the whole decline away from Dharma. It's the marketing. It's been used to market the free fall into a profane culture. Whatever the music, there's lots of different music used, was used in so many different ways. And I thought, oh, great, we're spreading music. You know, music is God. No, it's not God. You might say it's anti-God in a lot of ways. Distracts us from what we really need to be doing to realize God. Images too. Images, like taking pictures. I've stopped taking pictures for now, I've been cutting back for a long time, actually. And it's very amazing, very fascinating what happens when you do that. Before, my first reaction always was, "Oh, that's so beautiful. Let me take a picture." Now, it's true you can make the world seem more beautiful through photography. But you have to be very careful about trying to fixate an image about what's happening. You want to stay away from trying to fixate images. It's false marketing, anyway, to try to make this world look beautiful in that way. It's very false marketing. Kind of like music is false marketing. Leads us astray. So photography has led us astray. So much stuff. Actual contact with some of the saints have actually shown up in this world. So I actually saw them, I've seen them. So that's a blessing, and I've spoken of it. But really, people don't know what to say anymore. No one's ever really said anything. No feedback on it. It's like, what? The Dharmic culture talks to one another about the miraculous in their lives. And as I've said before, we should suspend, at this point, we should suspend any ex the laws of pretense, so to speak, the absurd laws of pretense, which is what we call nature. We should suspend those for a while and just say, I'm going to kind of ease off on those. As if God has to work. Wait, if we have to wait for some experience for the wheels of nature to turn, and maybe it'll happen, and maybe it won't. What? That's so absurd. And if we suspend, ease those laws and suspend some of them, allow them to be suspended for a while, then the saints can appear to us. It should be a time now when the saints start appearing and we start interacting with them. And well, they're just here to revitalize Dharmic culture. And this time it will be appearances, but throughout history, saints have appeared. They just appeared. Yogananda's book, Autobiography of a Yogi, talks about that quite a bit. That saints would simply manifest and appear. And then disappear. That's a true Dharmic. His book was talking about Dharmic culture. So I grew up with that. I said, wow, that's what I want. That's what I want my life to be. I want to live in a Dharmic culture. Unfortunately, it's gone the opposite direction here in the West. We tried, but the backlash, really was so strong, and now it's ridiculous. People are very much creature-like now. Like creatures. So that's not Dharmic at all. That's very profane. And they believe that we're bound by the so-called laws of nature, which are really just make-believe. We're pretending. We're pretending our arm's fixated and can only do certain things, based on cycles of nature, It tilts this way every couple thousand years. Arm tilts like this way, and then it tilts back every thousand years like this. And like there's some sort of laws of nature that are responsible for our pretension. I mean, talk about pretension, right? I mean, look at this. I put my arm fixated, and what if I just said, there's all these vast laws and physics and chemistry and everything that are responsible for this arm being fixated like this, and it has no choice but to be fixated because those are the laws, immutable laws of nature. And I just say, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? It's so absurd. But of course, people will say we're atrocious and absurd to even suggest that anything like that could happen. But it's getting to the point now where really we've tried everything else. I've tried everything in my life. 48 years of really testifying, really 60 years, because I started out testifying. It's really been 60 years of trying to empower the Dharma in the world. And you know, it's so I've tried everything, and it's time now to try something, you know, something better, something else that a little stronger, or maybe a lot stronger. And I don't know if that'll work. I don't, like I said, you could have a group of Dharma Kings walking through the world, and I don't know if anyone would even pay attention. I know. A lot of places I see, I pretty much guarantee you nobody would. I've been in some places that people are so preoccupied, there's not even a shred of Dharma. I could not even feel a shred of it. Not even a shred. And if Jesus appeared, they think, ah, oh, it's just another street performer, you know. Here's a dollar. See you later. I'm busy. So it's up to those of us who are still dharmic to pick up on what's going on. And don't allow the spirituality spin on it. There's something, you know, deeper than that. It's, you know, how am I giving up the pretense to creatureness, to ever being born? To bornness, which would is mean born into becoming. Becoming means you believe that you are in a process of becoming something. And of course, a body is necessary, whether it's subtle or gross body. The body is necessary to provide any evidence at all of becoming. It's strong. You know, we point to the body and say, "Well, look at the body. The body is becoming this. It's becoming that. It's becoming that." It's subject to the laws of nature and stuff like that. So, and we believe this is how we will find happiness, is to fixate the mind, which would mean the mind is now something that just is bound by becoming and not free in the now, not free in the moment. So I've stopped taking, you know, video, stopped taking my cameras with me and all that. And that's just a discipline. I was asked to do that by the Holy Spirit. So Dharmic people don't need pictures or videos of a saint, if a saint appeared. They listen, they trust someone says this, I had this experience, and they trust that this is what took place. They have to evaluate it, and it sinks in. It sinks in. They allow it to sink in because it's too profound. A picture is superficial, actually. It's very superficial. There's something, you know, much heavier going on than an image can really convey. That, you know, dates and places and times, all that's is very superficial, very superficial. A dharmic person is not really interested in that. Those of us who are dharmic, forget the superficial. We're interested in the fact that it did happen, and are you able to block the panic? And you go, of course, you just go into shock. How severe the wow, what the wow was, what kind of practice did you use to block the panic, or use the wow practice? And they're just, you know, we're very grateful for any one of us who actually experiences the contact with the saints. We're extremely grateful for that. And then you talk about it, you spread the news. As Jesus said, go out and spread the good news, spread the gospel. Otherwise, I don't know you. You're supposed to spread the Dharma, the fact of contact with these Dharma kings, with the saints and miracles, and like Christianity was all about the miracles, talking about the miracles, talking about the how the Holy Spirit was moving in their lives, and you know, the great works that were being done in their lives. And this went on for a long, long while. And it's, you know, unfortunately, it's has been severely eroded. And I know someone who's very, very much that way in a Christian church, and he says the church is just going to hell. I mean, it's so difficult. It's not working anymore. You know, it's tearing them apart. This is the great apostasy of these times. But how can we turn it around? How can we turn it around? I did this song called Turn It Around back in 1997. I saw, you know, all this was already happening back then. That was 20 years ago. I did all these songs that talk about, and they're very accurate to today, right now, actually. Turn it around, turn it around, it around. We have to turn it around in our lives. Dreams are helpful, but we call upon the Dharma Kings to, as I said, put your stamp on these times. Put your stamp on these times. They've put their stamp on every time throughout history, have they not? Look at Tibetan Buddhism. At what point were the great lamas not putting their, the gurus, not putting their stamp on the history, Tibetan history, starting with, you know, Padmasambhava, for instance? At what point were they not doing that? They've been doing it continuously, actually. So Jesus has been doing it recently with A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice, and then Dialogues and Awakening with Tom and Linda Carpenter. And then, you know, there are many who claim that they're channeling Jesus at this point. And that is what it is. But I'd like to go beyond words, actually, at this point. And actually meet with Jesus, for instance. Or whatever, Dharma Kings. Or not just meet, maybe see him, or, you know, some miracles or something more stronger than just words. You know, anybody can claim that they're, you know, channeling Jesus and write books. And they may have an agenda doing so or not. But the Dharma is stronger than that. The presence. The Dharma is based on the presence of the saints, the actual presence of them, not their words. The words are secondary. Chanasaring Chodron, the great Dakini, who's a companion of Jamyang Kanshi Choki Lodro, I believe that she actually appeared for me and did this very amazing empowerment of laughter, just peals of laughter, and then she just walked down and was gone. I don't know where she went, and it shook me up, and it reverberated throughout my psyche way more than any teaching could have done, actually. And that billboard of Shirdi Sai Baba just looking at me like that, you know, that it goes, it's stronger than words, actually. It's stronger. Just a glance, they say, sometimes just a glance from the guru, you know, that it you never, it shakes you to the core. On my 60th birthday, there was this picture of Ram Maharshi on my screen, and I came home and I turned to it, and his gaze just pierced me through and went right through me and hit my core. I felt it rocked in the core of my being. He got past all my words and concepts and images. And it just shook me up, you know, in a wonderful way. See, that's a blessing from a guru right there. So, I mean, pictures can help, but you have to be receptive. That gaze was more than a picture. Ramana was using it somehow to actually convey that the truth, you know, into my into in the core of my being. Quite extraordinary. So I commented on that, and so I share my experiences with the world like this, and this is how Dharmic culture is built up: is the sharing with the world, with everyone, what your experiences are. Testimony, the witnessing. I'd like to see, you know, in place of worship, you know, sometime people get up and testify, you know, this is what occurred to me, and God has been great. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen in the Catholic Church, where they it's kind of like on autopilot, you know. It needs to be more, you know, grounded in the immediacy of our experiencing right now, right here, right now. I mean, believe me, those saints didn't come into this world for us to be abandoned by them right now. You know? What are we supposed to be running on? Fumes? We're supposed to be calling upon them right now. They're supposed to be showing up right now. There's nothing special about someone 2,000 years ago or their culture back then or anything more than now. It's still pretense. We need to awaken from pretense. We need to awaken from pretense right now. It's always right now. Pretending is always right now. It's never based on time, process, time, space, process, or form at all. So they knew that back when they appeared, and so they know that it's exactly the same case right now. So we need them right now. That's always when we need them. So I'm kind of miffed. I say, like, you know, wow, I mean, you can't just expect us to keep living on words alone here. It only goes so far. And you can't expect us to say, well, yeah, I mean, St. Paul traveled around 2,000 years ago and 2,000 years ago. I want St. Paul to be here traveling around right now. I want to see St. Paul right now. How am I, are you any different than anyone that he spoke to back then? We're not different at all. We're still pretending that the mind can be fixated. We're trying to keep pretending until we believe that actually the mind will actually fixate. And it never does. It can never do so. So all our pretending is in vain. It's just aimless, wasting. And it's much ado about absolutely nothing, actually. And the saints don't have to be, you know, like Muji and Rishikesh. I mean, Muji is spreading the Dharma. He's doing his thing here, for instance, you know, just as an example. But they can just show up walking down the street. They can show up anywhere. They're not bound by the laws of this dream. Not at all. So the Dharma is not just about what spiritual teachers are here in the world physically, so to speak. It should be much wider than that. Much wider than that. It should include your dreams. It should we should allow for the saints appearing in the world whenever and however they want to. The miracles, the grace of God bringing about the miracles and synchronicities, which continue to take place, by the way, in a tremendous, astonishing way. And we should mention it and talk about it. That doesn't mean we have to not have our own life, and we don't have to open ourselves up to, you know, the crackpots of the world. But certainly we should spend time and effort to, if something, you know, happens, sharing it if it's so indicated. I've always tried to. My dad was very Dharmic. He always talked about synchronicity and the grace of God and the gurus and the showing. He was, you know, with him, you know, all conversation revolved around, hey, look at that, you know, wow, isn't that amazing? And that's exactly what I thought would happen, and the synchronicity here, and how it's all one and joined. And when that goes away, you know, it just, you severely miss it. You severely miss it. and there's really nothing to take his place. The older generation felt much more free and easy to be that way. And nowadays, you know, it's like you have to apologize. You know, if you use the term God or whatever, grace, you know, you've got to sort of preface it like, I apologize, oh, I don't offend anybody. Offend anybody? What, you're afraid of offending profane culture? They are an offense. They're the offense. They should do the apologizing. So they should say, I'm sorry, we're so profane and we're, you know, we're trying to drag, you know, Dharmic culture down. We apologize for that. And, you know, but that's how it used to be. Profane society knew they were profane, and they, in their hearts, they realized, yeah, wow, you know, we're not top dog at all. But now it's opposite. It's now Dharmic culture that has to be apologetic about itself to profane culture. It's completely reversed. And that reversal is never going to get anyone anywhere except the continual hell of being afraid that, you know, hallucination is suddenly going to vanish, which it could at any instant if we decide to. Hallucinating the absence of God, God's still there, okay? There's no way that God, we can make God not present everywhere. So this hallucinating the absence of God is just a mere, you know, hallucination that can end instantly. So we always will have this severe insecurity. Profane culture is always severely insecure. The good thing about the present time is the profane culture is much more obvious now. Whereas before, it was more sneaky. It was sneaky. It was very sneaky. Sort of self-righteously sneaky, but now it's obviously very profane. And so that gives us a heads up. We say, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, so we don't want that. So let's now start choosing Dharmic culture. It's a choice. We can say, okay, you know what? I can see creature culture and I can see Dharmic culture. Which one do I want? I get to choose. Don't try to alternate. Don't try to accommodate both of them. You cannot. Opposite directions, opposite purposes. One is trying to fixate the mind so that the hallucinating the absence of God will be permanent, and we believe that we have created a new creation separate from God. And the other realizes that's an impossible dream. And we have to overcome our familiarity and expectations, the fear we have when we don't meet our expectations, we surpass our expectations and we go past them. We have to overcome that. And we have to work at it. That's Dharmic culture. So very, very different cultures. And you know, sheep and goats is how the Bible puts it. And we're said that the sheep and goats will part ways at the end of this cycle, out of this age. Well, it certainly looks that way. I mean, I've been in some places recently where the creature culture was so strong, it was like an alien species. I was sitting there looking at watching people watch. I said, wow, I don't, these people have nothing, you know, virtually nothing in common with me at all. It's like, it might as well be in a different planet. They're aliens to me. Aliens. They don't speak my language or culture or anything even remotely. Yet, you know, we're still breathing. The only, you know, similarity was both our bodies are breathing and moving and maybe uttering something. But other than that, you know, there's not a whole lot of similarity at all. And they look at me that way. A lot of times people just look like I'm a ghost. I'm not even there. They don't see any similarity at all in my mind with their mind is focused on. So that's what's happened, and it's invested now in, the vested interests are so strongly vested in it. Healthcare industry, the massive Goliath of healthcare, the massive religion of healthcare, actually. That's enough right there. That's a deal breaker for me. I mean, the situation with healthcare is so crazy, and pharmaceutical industry, etc. That right there, you know, say, hey, let's choose Dharmic culture, and that's it. So I'm just eager to experience a much more Dharmic culture at this point. And trying to prove it to a profane culture is useless. Those who believe they're creatures, they don't want to, superficially, everybody tries to play nice. But what I found out is that something that's happened throughout my life is profane culture wants me dead. There's no question about it. And there's been a lot of attempts. There's another attempt really on my life recently. And I was warned about it very severely ahead of time. And I actually asked Padmasambhava for help because I knew that there was going to be an attempt. And there most certainly was. And fortunately, I was able to avoid it by profane culture. I actually did a little ritual. It was amazing beforehand. I said, wow, I know someone's really out to get me. The culture, profane culture, is really out to get me. But on the surface, of course, they won't say that. They'll call it an accident or something. This is how they... There's no such thing as accidents. I've had many situations where, my intuition, I was safe from accidents that was trying to take me out, because they feel that Dharmic culture is ruinous to their destiny of happiness, which is to fixate the mind. And of course, I know the mind cannot be fixated. All you can do is oscillate, and if you do that all in, you have total mental chaos. And you say, I don't want this. This is terrible. And that's it. You cannot fixate the mind. It's impossible. So I'm just trying to help everyone save them suffering, but they don't like that. They'll be very nice and pious and righteous. In the background, they're saying, how can we get rid of this guy? That's profane culture, that's for sure. So it is difficult when the people you're trying to help or they're trying to take you out. That's not an ideal situation, but that's been the case throughout history, hasn't it been? Look what they did, to Jesus. They were constantly trying to take him out. We gotta get rid of this guy. He's ruinous to our hopes, they said. But what he was came to tell us is where true hope is. What will really work for us, and to give up what is hopeless. You just said, look, what you're trying to do is hopeless. It's totally hopeless. And so you're caught up in oscillating between hope and fear. You deny the hopelessness of it, and in doing that, you make it dualistic, where you have some hope, true, and then you account for the hopelessness of it by fear. And then you oscillate between those two, and that's called, in Tibetan Buddhism, we call it that, the ocean of samsara, between hope and fear. There's this vast ocean of choppiness, of bits of hope and fear that we're trying to cling to and trying to find this hope and fear, and that's horrible. And so we just say, look, we cannot fixate the mind. And a non-fixated mind is not an abyss, it's unbounded, instantaneous experiencing. It's the impossibility of an abyss, actually. It's the impossibility of the absence of all value everywhere, always. That's God. God is always present. So an abyss is impossible. But they think that realizing that an abyss is impossible is an abyss. So that's obviously absurdity, isn't it? Obviously, that's absurdity. But I know the people up here, Northern California, they don't want me. They don't want me here. There's no doubt about it. They'll never say that. But the reading, looking beneath the surface, is very, very obvious. I'm a persona non grata here, that is for sure. And so, hopefully, I can spend some time elsewhere, which is feels like a blessing to me. And maybe we can all spend some time elsewhere, actually. And start moving, and I've started moving in that direction, really. I've been talking about that before, in getting in more and more sublime situations, places, that one of two things. One, profane culture, seeing what the best profane culture has to offer, and then saying, ah, that's nothing. I can live without that, no problem. And then also seeing some foreshadowing of a much more beautiful, experiencing more of a more dharmic world, so to speak, and experiencing that, and just saying, wow, everywhere I look, it's so beautiful. I'm stuck to my tracks. Let me just sit here for an hour in the wow, just from seeing a leaf, move, or just something is just the somehow. You catch the beauty of it, and you just say, wow, it's just, I just, all thoughts stopped, all imagery stopped. And you allow yourself to be transported beyond concepts and imagery and words. That's a dharmic place. It sort of facilitates, you allow yourself to be transported into a deeper, the deep mind, so to speak, beyond the superficiality. So I stopped trying to capture it in the image and said, let it permeate me. I'd rather be permeated by it. That's what happened. That's what happened. So I've been experiencing this, being permeated by beauty without trying to represent it in any way. Someone actually asked me, did you take pictures? Have you been taking pictures? And I said, no. I said, I can't do justice. By taking pictures just doesn't do it justice. And he kind of goes, huh. Kind of surprised him. Because he knows I'm a big picture taker, videographer, etc. But I said, that's not the point of it. The point of it is to let it permeate you, and you have to be in the mood, and it can be anything. It can be anything. A little bird flies through the air and lands on a tree branch. But everything is just such that it's the most exquisite thing you've ever seen. And you can feel it's profound. Everything is profound. So that's a blessing. So I've been greatly blessed recently, to say the least. But I really worked for it, and continue to in every which way. And I encourage all of you to allow yourself to be put in really beautiful places. More and more and more and more, such that you feel empowered to actually do nothing. And when you feel empowered to do nothing, you will find that everything begins to become more and more exquisite, because you don't have to form an image about it, or a concept, or fashion it into some answer, into some pill for anyone to take, or you don't have to take a picture of it. You don't have to freeze it in a picture. And so everything becomes more and more subtly exquisite and profound. It's like that. Saw some clouds in the sky just floating up, and it was perfect. That's the most beautiful clouds I've ever seen, and everything was the most beautiful array of clouds I've ever seen in my life. It was so profound, I can't even explain it. I was just in shock by how beautiful it all seemed. But for everyone else, just just some clouds. Okay? Nothing to, you know. Or others might say, okay, I'm going to get a click. I got a picture of it. But I just allowed it to be there. And it was very, very, very amazing. And this just, you know, went on and on and on and on and on. So that's being dharmic right there. That, and then reporting to this in terms of the gist of it, right? The profane want to focus on the superficiality. Where were you? What time was it? You know, what day was it? You know, how long did it last? They want to measure it. The profane are always calculating and measuring. That's profane culture. Whereas Dharmic culture would not even be interested in that nonsense. They're picking up on, hey, I can do this too. I can do this too. And I get what you're saying. Wow. Don't form an image of anything. Just allow your mind to be free of trying to get an answer for anyone, because the answer is everywhere. The answer is that we have everything right now. That's the answer, and the grace of God will send you the experiencing that you're ready for to help you awaken from the pretension that it's otherwise. So when we trust in the grace of God, we don't worry about calculating and labeling and naming and words, okay? We don't worry about that. We trust in the grace of God, and it's helpful for others to share their experiencing and say, yeah, it worked. It certainly has been working in my case. Now, dare we put ourselves to the test, put grace of God to the test, and call it the 99 days of Dharma. the 99 Dharma days of summer. 99 Dharma days of summer. I don't know. Put it to the test that way. I went through an intensive before last year where God said, every day I'm going to make it more and more sublime for you. And God did. He absolutely did so. And he did use video in that. Do slow motion video and stuff. That can be profound, but I wonder if just not doing videos can be even more profound. I don't know. Possible, right? Ninety-nine Dharma days of summer, where every day we allow ourselves to experience even greater connection with experiencing, you know, the deep mind feeling in the deep way, beyond creature feeling, okay? Beyond creature feeling. Beyond the sensations and emotions of what we call creatureness, all that stuff. Go deeper than that, deeper. And we feel profound, something much more profound. I had another dream where I was gliding. I was going down a road, and I was up on my toes, and like I was ice skating down the road, kind of. I was just gliding. Whenever I went up on my toes, I just glided. I wonder what in the world that was about. It was amazing. I could walk, but then I got up on my toes. I was like Mercury with wings on my toes. I was able to just glide along like I was on a skateboard or something, you know, rapidly, really, really fast. I could go really, really fast. There are still Dharmic, lots of us in the world. It's just that culture is trying to marginalize us to such an extent that we're not speaking up anymore. And that's how the Dharma dies. When Dharmic people do not speak up, that's how the Dharma dies, because we begin to infer that there's nobody else out there, right? So I've tried to generate as large a many people as possible listening to this and paying attention, just to inspire others. Say, oh, look, you know, he's getting so many views, you know, which is, you know, so people are interested in this. I can be interested in too. So that's what I'd hope to do. It hasn't worked out that way. I don't know why exactly, but I'd love to have millions of views just to inspire others, say, hey, we can do this. It's okay to focus on this. It's okay to do it. Lots of others are doing it. It's kind of like that. The more that's doing it, the more we'll do it, because they see, oh yeah, join in the crowd. There's lots of, so I won't be isolated or alone if I do this, if I talk this way. But, profane culture says that it's profane to talk about God. And they only want God talked about in the way, their way, in a very profane way. And not in a really dharmic way like we do here, where really it's the focus on the grace of God and how we're being woken up beyond words to the realization that we've just been pretending that the mind is fixated. It's never been fixated. Not even for an instant. There's never been an instant or an instance of the mind being fixated. Never, and never will be. And yet we think there's an entire universe, billions of years old, that proclaims the opposite of that. But again, I say in a dream, or when you're pretending, at what point is that not pretending? At what point is pretending not in the now? At what point is pretending not in the now? Right now. So where's the mental fixation then? If it's moment by moment, pretending is moment by moment, instant by instant, where is the fixation of the mind happening? So I asked the Dharma Kings to put their stamp on this era we're in right now, these times we're in right now. Put their stamp on it. They haven't yet put their stamp on it. We deserve it. Everyone deserves that. Because most of the world is under the false impression. They think that, hey, we finally have fixated the mind to the extent that the Dharma Kings can't show up anymore. They're not able to get through the fixation, the crystallization that's happened. There's not been any crystallization happen. But if they don't show up, this is the impression that the world will get. But if you do some of those good old songs I listen to, talking about Jesus, just such great songs. I mean, it just, you can't touch them these days. But nobody will listen. It's like it's not contemporary enough. They want the to feel that something's crystallized. All these, we're finally getting there. We're finally crystallizing the mind, fixating it. No, not at all. Again, at what point is the dream of a dreamer not right now for the dreamer? When is the dreamer dreaming a dream that's not right now? When is dreaming not happening right now? If we're dreaming, like let's say we're reverie or something, or daydreaming. We're daydreaming. At what point in that daydreaming is the daydreaming not happening right now? Is there ever any daydreaming that is not taking place right now? The dreamer is not dreaming right now? Not imagining right now? Don't try to grasp it. It's so obvious that if you try to grasp it, you'll lose it. This is truth. Truth is so obvious. The very act of trying to grasp it, that's when you lose it. So we practice not grasping anything at all. No answers. No grasping. What have we attained? Nothing. No attainment. No attainment. No enlightenment. No answers. And just abide in that. And then the self-evidency of it all will simply be there. We don't have it. As soon as we think we have it, it's no longer self-evident. it's denying the self-evidency of it. We are it. How can we need to have it? As soon as we think I need to have this, we're saying, well, I'm somehow not it yet. It brings time into the picture, belief in time. We are it. At what point are we not it? Can we ever not be it? Can a dreamer ever say that the dream is not happening right now? It's not dreaming right now? How can the dreamer say that? What a salesman. We heard this Irish priest. Oh my gosh. You talk about, now I know why, you know, the greatness of the Irish priest. What a salesman he was. He had us eating out of his hands. He almost had me. He's talking about the Holy Spirit and how Jesus left. He said he put us in charge of the Holy Spirit, in charge of us, the Spirit of Truth, the Comforter. He says, I'm, and this is very clear in Christianity that, you know, the Holy Spirit is what we're supposed to, while Jesus is gone, it's the Holy Spirit we're supposed to turn to. And so here the priest is making it very clear this is it. And then he says, but you know, and then he starts spinning it. and he spun it in such a lovely way, you know, it's still the same lovely voice and the humor and everything, that you just want to kind of go along with it. But then, you know, he spun and said, but the Virgin Mary, you know, you need to turn to your mother sometimes, you know. And then the body and the blood of Jesus, you know, that's where it's really at. I mean, that's the actual, what really helps you, you know. So we ended up with the Eucharist and the Virgin Mary, whereas we started with the Holy Spirit. I said, wait a minute. You know, yeah, but I said, look, you know, as charming as you are, you couldn't get that one past me. Okay, but I could see how you could get it past most. The way he spoke was so lilting and so beautiful, and the sing-songiness and you know, and the humility, and I am just a liar, you know, I'm just here to share with you, my brethren, the love and grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And, you know, let me tell you about this. Oh, everyone's laughing. And oh my God, we're just having a love fest here, you know. But somehow we got away from the Holy Spirit. He managed to lead us away from the Holy Spirit. So, fortunately, we don't have a priest like that where I go to, and it's more easy to see through. It's kind of like, oh man, here we go again, you know. A dangerous thing to have a salesman like that, who is able to kind of lead you away from the truth like that. So I was going to, you know, thank him before he did that. I said, oops, I'd have to castigate him for that. You know, I said, hey, you know, you're leading the flock astray, actually. Jesus said, the body profiteth nothing, and then he proved it. People didn't believe him, and then he said, okay, here, you want my body? Take my body. Crucify my body. It's all the same to me. The body profiteth nothing. And I'll prove to you that I'm, it's not just words, okay? It's the truth. It's the truth. So the belief that we're a creature, the belief in creatureness, it profits us nothing. And he said, "It's his the bread of life is the word, that the teachings that he gave us. It's his spiritual teachings that he gave us. That's the bread of life that leads to eternal life. Not his body or his flesh. Not the creatureness at all. So he shed the blood of the creature to show us that it's worthless. I mean, if it was valuable, why? Then that means God what, wants to kill what's valuable? That's terrible. That's ridiculous. What he was saying is, no, there's no value in it whatsoever. Otherwise, he'd be agreeing to destroy value. That would be insane. So he was saying, Jesus was showing us, look, there's no real value to creatureness at all. Okay? And so he wasn't just talking the talk, he was walking the walk as well. But what everyone, not everyone, but what they're aiming for in the Eucharist really is to get this special creatureness from Jesus, special creatureness, and make the body, you know, eternal creatureness. That's what they're after, eternal creatureness. Okay, that's not what Jesus is after. We are to recognize that creatureness is a mere pretense on our part. It's all pretending. And then he showed us it was mere pretense by resurrecting the body. He said, look, it was just in a pretending, and I can pretend again for you. No problem. No problem. And then a jaw dropper said, what? I mean, if you're a creature, we kill the creature, they can't rise from the dead like that. And Jesus says, no, you're not a creature. You're God's eternal Son. Spirit, formless spirit, and you're just pretending to be a creature. But you don't have to stop pretending. The important thing is to recognize you're pretending. You don't have to kill the body. The body is really not the creatureness. The creatureness is our desire to try and fixate the mind, actually. And you can give that up, but you don't have to give up the body. The body can still be a communication device here. And it's probably best that we do it that way. We don't want to, you know, Jesus did that and showed, and that's enough. That struck a chord. But now, you know, maybe we'll see if we can, what the Dharma Kings will do for us right now. This is what being Dharmic right now means that we have to accept what the Dharma Kings will do for us right now. You know, whatever it is, I don't know exactly what it's going to be, but we have to put up with it, whatever it is. It may be more than we think we want or deserve. And we just say, wow, this is incredible. I've been given some blessings recently that are, you know, quite incredible, quite beautiful, quite sublime. And you know, it's tough to accept it because you know, profane culture is you know, they're hell bent on, you know, celebrating creatureness through death. How do you prove you're a creature except through dying? How do you try to prove you're a creature? Through dying, of course. Spirit can't die, but creatures can. So we have this pretense of dying to try and prove that we really are creatures, and therefore we really did fixate the mind. We really can't fixate the mind. After all, death has to be the death of something, right? Something. But if we've never been born, how can there be death at all? There's not even any opportunity for death. And this is the case, actually. There's no death because there's no opportunity for death at all. Death doesn't even exist, can never exist. Death can never exist, actually. Never. Okay. That's a good note to end upon, isn't it? That's very profound. So tomorrow, maybe Memorial Day in the United States, I think was it the 29th? Yeah, 29th of May, which here is the official start of summer from to Labor Day, September or something. I don't know what it is, 6th or something. It's 99 days of summer, I call it. 99 days of summer. And so how is that going to be? What is this going to be like? We have to bring it, really. We really have to bring our willingness and just say, okay, you know, let's lay it on the line here. And accept what Dharmic culture presents to us, and don't oscillate. You know, just accept it, whatever it may be. You know, I don't know what it's going to be. Whatever it may be, just say, okay, you know, this is it, and I have to get used to it. I have to get familiar with it. That's plain and simple. I have to get familiar with this. It's an obligation. Part of Dharmic culture, we have to get familiar with interaction with the saints, with the presence. We have to get familiar with that the presence is here for us, and it's available for us, and there are those who are experiencing it, and we have to experience it also. And we do have to wake up, and we will go through this awakening. We have to accept that this is our life. This is our life. And we don't have some other life. Okay? We're not oscillating. This is 100% our life. Very great. We will bring this one to a close. The 99 Dharma days of summer. 99 Dharma days of summer 2017. Possible, huh? I just put that out there as a possible segue. And, see, we will feel it. Whatever it is, we're going to feel it and experience it. All right, that's it for this one.